We're going to have a look at an overview of what 802.11ac brings that's new. So some of the growth goals and the timelines for this. So this stuff gets out of date on a daily basis, the growth and timelines. There's a couple of features that are now involved in 802.11ac, which weren't in N. So things like beamforming, which is more inherent now. It was used in N, but now it's more used in a slightly more complex form. And, of course, as a test equipment manufacturer, we're concerned with enabling customers to test this stuff and deploy it from chipset all the way through to finished product. So we'll look at some of the design challenges, the test challenges, both on a transmitter and receiver. And I'm not going to go through a product pitch because I think that'll bore everybody to death, but the material is in the handouts that you're going to get with the notes as well. So I won't go into a lot of detail on the products. So this market update, as I said, is out of date as soon as you print it. This slide set was originally developed in 2012 when it was looking forward to the standard. The standard is now out. The 802.11ac standard finally got ratified in around November last year. And I had a look on the Wi-Fi.org website the other day, and already there's about 411 Wi-Fi.org certified products out on the market. A lot of them TV sets, actually. But the list is growing all the time. As I said, this also looks back at the 11N standard, which was the standard that was in long development and took so long to be ratified that a lot of manufacturers jumped the gun and released pre-N product. So that is now certified, and there's around 11,500 products, again, that carry the Wi-Fi org certification just for 802.11n. So the kind of things where these things are being deployed is in things like smartphones. Everybody, you buy a phone these days, it's got Wi-Fi in it. Cameras, you know, to transfer your pictures to your PC or whatever. E-readers like the Kindle. Media players. Games consoles, you know, Xboxes and PlayStations all have Wi-Fi in them these days. Even Blu-ray players, you know, just bog-standard Blu-ray players, you can put them on the network and download stream TV programs. And, of course, as I said, HD televisions and things like printers as well. So what's also interesting is that the initial early adopters for the standard were actually the home users. They seem to be more ready to accept new technologies than corporates. Corporates tend to sit back a while and say, is it safe? What are the holes in the security before they adopt it? But now a lot of the corporations and companies have adopted and deployed 802.11n around their buildings. And say the growth in the corporate market is now larger than it is in the domestic market. I think the domestic market for N is probably saturating. So the corporate market is now catching up. And, of course, there's things like smart metering, medical applications. A lot of these things, though, have competing technologies like Zigbee and all those other kind of things as well, competing for the same utilization. But what's also interesting is when you start to look at things like wireless LAN, you all see wireless LAN and Bluetooth in a phone. So a lot of the chipsets these days have chipset development for both technologies and sometimes FM radios as well. And one of the challenges for the chipset developer and the finished equipment manufacturer is to make sure that these radios don't interfere with each other. So that's where we play our part in the whole development process. So talking about some of the new applications that are driving the 11th standard, you can see interactive video conferencing, internet video streaming, high definition television, Blu-ray players, and just if you look at the high-definition television down there, if you look at the data rate that's required for that, it's about 796 megabits per second for the good quality, and for uncompressed video, it's around 3,730 or 3.7 gigabits per second. So 802.11n doesn't really satisfy that. And so we take a step back and have a look at where the standard comes from. So the first products that came out with the 802.11 specification was the B series back in 1997. And, you know, in those days, 2 megabits per second was great, you know. You know, when you have a downlink on your ADSL at that time, it's probably 256K, 2 megabits between devices was fantastic. Nowadays, it's a bit passé and slow. Use this direct sequence spread spectrum technology or frequency hopping spread spectrum. Then they moved over to using an 11 megabit system. Same kind of modulation, though, in those days. And then the 802.11a standard came out, which was using OFDM technology. And this is where the game changes, and the OFDM technology underpins now all of the current N standards, apart from the legacy B standards. That operated in the 5 gigahertz band rather than the 2.4 gigahertz band. So the 2.4 gigahertz band, once upon a time, was the, you know, the domain of microwave ovens and not much else, actually. But now every unlicensed radio bearer comes out around the 2.4 gig band. It's a pretty heavily used piece of spectrum these days. Then the derived from the 802.11a standard was the 802.11g standard, which did the same modulation scheme, but at 2.4 gig. So these two basically are the same thing, but they're separated by the band that they operated in. Same headline specification, 54 megabit per second throughput, data rate. And that, again, that was great in its day, and everybody thought this is good stuff. And then, as I said, the 802.11n standard started to come out, and this started to introduce concepts like MIMO. Okay, everyone familiar with MIMO? Okay, well, I'm going to cover it a bit later on anyway, a little bit, but not too much detail. So using multiple input, multiple output transmission schemes to improve throughput, the standard actually recognized two bandwidths, 20 megahertz and 40 megahertz. But in Europe, for instance, there's not much 20 megahertz or 40 megahertz contiguous spectrum available. You know, when you look at the allocations of bands, there's quite a lot of overlapping that goes on. And so there was supposed to be a good neighbor policy between these radios, so that if they transmitted at 40 and found that somebody else was transmitting, you know, in an overlapping band, they were supposed to say, oh, sorry, I'll step back and go to 20. Okay. Of course, nobody wants to throttle their... everyone wants the best performance they can get, but that was supposed to be the way that these things were supposed to help to interoperate with each other. And again, this operated in both 2.4 gigs and 5.8 gig bands, so there's dual band products out there already that support that. And then I'll go along this line a little bit before I come down this line. If we go over here, there's also an 802.11p standard, which has been ratified for vehicle transmissions. Leveraged off some of this stuff, but lower data rate, 27 megabits per second, narrower bandwidth, 10 megahertz bandwidth. And also in America, more so than here at the moment, because when they sold off the TV, closed down the analog TV in America, they released some of this as what they call white space spectrum and decided what we're going to start doing with it. So there's another candidate for 802.11AF for utilizing the white space spectrum in countries that have got that white space. So we go back down to our original path now. So driving this need for more data rate, again, as I said, video devices in the home, we've now come across the topic I'm going to talk about today, which is 802.11AC. This is giving very high throughput rates below with carrier frequencies below 6 gigahertz. Okay. There is another standard, which is called the YGIG standard, which operates around 60 gigahertz, okay, with about 2 gigahertz of bandwidth, modulation bandwidth, and can be more, actually. That can carry an awful lot of data over a very short range. It's designed to be like a cable replacement in some cases for things like HDMI cables. So it's a short distance, but very high data rate. And that is also under development, and I think it's been absorbed back into the Wi-Fi.org specification family. For a while, it branched out on its own, but I think they've harmonized and made up, and it's all part of the one happy family again. So let's have a look at this. So the goal for 802.11ac was to get away from the 600 megabit per second that we could get on 802.11n with MIMO, driving for a 1 gigabit per second, say, basically like gigabit Ethernet replacement on over the air, okay? One of the things you notice with Wi-Fi is that, you know, it tries to target what can you do over a cable connection and offer the customer the same kind of experience over the air. So that was the part of the goal. It was developed under a task group called the 802.11ac task group, or TGAC. The draft specification was released in October 2012, and it was surprising how quickly after that there was actually pre-release product on the market that you could buy. The standard was completed last year eventually, and Wi-Fi Alliance certification is now completed, and as I said, there's over 411 products that were certified when I checked on Tuesday. So if you want the list of the products that are available, that you can download that that link, and they give it you in a nice handy spreadsheet so you can go through and cut it whichever way you like and look at the class of products that are being certified, which manufacturers, etc., etc. So the market research firms, of course, they have to put out reports because that's how they make their living. They reckon that by this year, starting and into next year, AC will become the dominant product, overstepping N, because effectively it's an enhancement to N anyway, and it has to backwards interoperate with N. Okay, but the looking for a new product to ship, having that AC badge on it is going to attract customer opinion. And if you look at your favourite consumer website for electronic products, you'll already find that there's lots of products listed with the AC specification or name on it. But back in 2012, there was already an early product from the likes of Asus, Belkin, Buffalo, D-Link, Netgear, Edimax, routers for less than $200. And, of course, the price erosion on those has already kicked in, so you can buy them for less than that. And also there was USB adapters for the products as well. Of course, what's interesting is if you ever get the full data rate from one of these adapters, you don't use a USB 2 port, because the USB 2 port will actually have less data throughput than the over-the-air maximum data rate. So if you get anywhere near the 700 or the 1 gigabit per second, your USB 2 port will throttle you back to 480 megabits per second maximum anyway. So if you ever use one of these, you try and find a USB 3 port on your PC. Okay, and also, of course, now you're finding PCs shipping with these products in. So when you look at the certified list of products, PCs are among them already as well. So chipsets, manufacturers, the likes of Broadcom, Qualcomm, Theros, using the name more Qualcomm these days, MediaTek, Marvell, Intel, Quantenna, they're all shipping product already, some supporting 3x3 and 4x4 MIMO. So if you have a look at the what was core to the 802.11n specification, you can see that the transmission method that was mandated was OFDM. There was a channel bandwidth of 20 megahertz, and I said there was an optional one with that good neighbor policy. There was an FFT size of 64 and an optional with a 40 megahertz of 128. The subcarrier, data subcarrier and pilots, there was 52 data subcarriers and 4 pilot channels. And again, if you go over to the 40 meg, there was 108 and 6 pilots. Subcarrier spacing is always 312.5 kilohertz. So between the OFDM carriers is always about 312.5 kilohertz. There was an OFDM symbol duration of 4 microseconds with an 800 nanosecond guard interval. And in the 40 meg channel, there was a 3.6 microsecond with a shorter 400 nanosecond guard interval to get higher throughput. The modulation type supported were anything from BPSK. The pilots are normally transmitted as BPSK. The data could be transmitted as QPSK, 16 QAM or 64 QAM. Okay. So the modulation coding schemes that were available allowed you to go to 64 QAM. Now, with all of wireless and radio technologies, they always start off in the early days with something simple and easy to demodulate like BPSK or QPSK. And as the demand for data goes up, they say, damn, you know, we've got to give in and go to higher order QAMs. All of that comes with an increasing complexity for things like amplifiers, things like local oscillators have got to be cleaner to get the phase noise performance between symbols as well. So they all start off simple and then get more complicated. So there was a binary convolutional coding or BCC forward error correction, and then there was an LDPC low density parity check in the 40 megahertz band. The coding rates were, you can read them for yourself. So the modulation coding schemes, which give you the combinations of modulation types and coding rates to give you the different data throughputs. So it supported MCS 7, 0 to 7 and 0 to 15 for access points. And then there was another set of coding schemes over here for the 40 megs channels. So there was spatial streaming for MIMO. This is optional as well. So one or two for access points and with the direct mapping. And three or four streams with transmit beamforming, space-time block coding for the 40 megahertz channel. And you can notice here that in this mode, there was a legacy. So these things had to backwards operate with 802.11g, for instance, and even B. So, you know, if you had product there that was trying to talk to you, you still had to support those legacy modes of operation as well. But then there was a high throughput mode that's defined for the new clean standard. And then over here in the 40 megahertz channel, there was what we called a greenfield high throughput mode of operation. Okay, and that's for 802.11n only. So these here, these mixed mode ones, supported the backwards from A, B, and G as well. So that was all core to N. When we move over to AC, remember all that happened in N. And so these are some of the new additional things that were brought into the AC standard over the top of N. So wider channels, higher modulation orders, more spatial streams and antennas, up to 8 antennas inside the devices, and multi-user MIMO. And also, the operation for the AC signal is purely in the 5 to 6 gigahertz band. It doesn't operate down at 2.4 gigs at all. So the items in red are the changes compared to the 802.11n standards. So you notice now the channel bandwidths used to stop at 40 as an option in N. Now they go to 80. And there's an option to go to 160 and also a kind of a carrier aggregated mode where you can put 80 plus 80 together. And there's reasons for this, which we'll talk about in a moment. FFT sizes, you can read here. Data subcarriers, again, you can see the change from that's what was in N. This was optional in the 40 megahertz. So notice now with the 80 megahertz, we've now got 234 data subcarriers with 8 pilots. And again, if you go over to the 160 meg version, 468 carriers and 16 pilots. Modulation types start to get interesting again because now we support up to 256 QAM. So we've jumped from 64 QAM up to 256 to support this higher throughput rate. So now the MCS band modulation coding schemes that are supported go from 0 to 7 here, but also we add 8 and 9 here, which support the 256 QAM transmission methods, okay, or schemes. So spatial multi-streams and MIMO, one was mandated here. Up to two, anywhere between 2 and 8 is optional in the enhanced or extended standard. Transmit beamforming, this gets a bit of a new kick. It's still in there, but it takes on a different method of operation. And space-time block coding, multi-user MIMO, which we'll talk about in a second. And the operating mode is very high throughput, or VHT mode. So the headline is that if you're using the modulation coding scheme 8 or 9, and you've got a full 160 megahertz of modulation bandwidth, and 8 transmit antennas, and a short guard interval, you can get somewhere like 6.93 gigabits per second over this link. Okay, so that's going downhill, brakes off, accelerator full on, right, you can get a headline spec of 6.9. In a typical case, though, more kind of the 80 meg products which are shipping at the moment with 4 transmitters and then an MCS9 coding scheme, you could get something like 1.5 gigabit per second, which is still a lot better than the 600 we could get in the 802.11n. So this is a look at the channelization that's employed for this system. And you notice that you can think of these 80 meg bands as chunks of 20 meg sub N bands bolted together. Okay, so each one of them, if you look at each one of these carrier groups, it looks like a 20 meg channel, and another one next to it, and another one next to it with a set of pilots scattered through them as well. What the problem is as I said, this is operating in the 5 gigahertz band, and in that band, there's only one available 160 megahertz contiguous piece of spectrum available. right, in all countries. If you look in some countries, there's weather radar systems working around this band here, so that precludes using that second 160 megahertz band here. And then what you also we have is the 80 megahertz band, and there's an option here to aggregate two 80 megahertz channels to give you a 160 megahertz throughput. So this is one of those cases where, again, we take pieces of spectrum that are available, which are not contiguous, and I call it scavenging. You know, we scavenge a piece of spectrum here and put it together with another piece of spectrum here to give us the throughput that we want. And we're seeing this with things like LTE now as well. The next generation LTE systems are going to use carrier aggregation, whether within the band or within band interbands. But this is a set of allocations which are supported in this standard. And one of the things that's got to work is that this has got to be backwards compatible with N, right? So when we look at the mapping of the symbol fields here, you'll notice that there's some training sequence fields, etc., that there's long... So when you transmit these things, there's normally a piece of information that's transmitted to train your receiver, so it can work out its phase and equalization characteristics to receive the rest of the data. So there's coding here that tells the receiver various things about what to expect. And in this field here, in the 802.11n standard, we transmitted two BPSK signals at 90 degrees to each other. Okay, so the two symbols were those two, a BPSK going like that, another BPSK going like that. So when you look at them in the constellation diagram, it looks like a cross. But there's actually two separate BPSKs going on. And they call this a QBPSK, a quadrature BPSK. What we do in the 802.11ac, in the same field, we transmit one symbol, which is a BPSK, and another symbol, which is a QBPSK. And the reason for that is that when the receiver in the device sees it, it then knows, is this an N transmission or is this an AC transmission? And then it reads the rest of the packet data to say, what's the following transmission going to be? Is it 256? Is it 64? Quam, etc., etc. So there's a bunch of steering bits right at the start of the two packets. So there's a very high throughput data field, and a high throughput data field. This is the N coding scheme. This is the AC coding scheme. And so this field here is the significant flag that tells the receiver, is this an AC or an N packet you're going to get next? Okay. So there are these preambles I mentioned, which are, again, for equalizer training, also for doing things like setting the AGC controls in the receive amplifiers. And these are all encoded in these early symbols here. I'm not going to go through these in a great deal of detail because we cover them in the notes as well. Blimey. So, MIMO, very quickly. All of the coding schemes that we used to use for diversity previously basically were to give us robustness of the signal. So they didn't give us any enhancement in the data throughput. They were, you know, if we use things like MISO, with some multiple transmitters, single receivers, or there's also SIMO and MISO. You can read all of the different acronyms there. So we've got a little diagram that explains the transmit to receive configurations. All of those were not to give you any improvement in data because it's the same data being transmitted on both paths, whereas it's to give you robustness and redundancy in the data. When we go to MIMO, you know, in most radio systems, interference or co-channel interference is a pain. You know, if you've got multipath, it's a real pain. You want to get rid of it. Most equalizers are designed to get rid of multipath in traditional radio systems. In MIMO, what we want to do is to take advantage of the multipath and send different information along each of the paths so that when the receiver aggregates the signal, the data is a sum, matrix sum, of all the data that's going across the different paths. So if you're in a room and you've got a MIMO transmitter and a MIMO receiver and there's no multipath between them, you actually don't get much throughput gain, right? If the receiver and the transmitter can see each other without a kind of a reflection of any sort to support the MIMO effect, you don't actually get an improvement in the throughput. It doesn't give you much gain at all. It really does rely on having reflections of the signal. I'm not going to go through this, so I'll let you read that. This is what to do with the mapping of the data. What also comes along in a bit more detail in this scheme is beamforming. Okay, is everyone familiar with beamforming? So the basic concept of beamforming is you've got a transmitter here and a receiver there. You've got an access point here. You've got one the device over there, another device over there, right? Well, the basic idea is if you're sending packets of information to that one, you don't really want to send it over to that one because you're wasting energy. If you can make the beam point at that receiver when you're talking to it and make the beam point at that receiver when you're talking to it, then you can get better coverage, better reach. So this beamforming technique basically relies on altering the phase and magnitude of the signal that you drive to the various antennas in combination to steer the beam and create gains in some areas and nulls in other areas. So the good point about that is while you're communicating with that one, you're not causing additional interference with that one over there because you've actually attenuated the signal. Okay. So the whole point of beamforming is basically to electronically steer the beam rather than just do a free space radiation pattern. In the 802.11n standard, the beamforming was what they called implicit. So in other words, when you sent a sounding packet to the receiver, you assume that the characteristics of the channel were the same in both directions. Okay. So there was a implicit kind of understanding that whatever was good in that direction was good in the reverse direction. When we go to N, they use what's called an explicit kind of feedback scheme, and the differences are covered in these couple of slides here. So a sounding packet gets sent and we in the implicit form, and we assume that the channel is reciprocal. When you go to the explicit form, the packet sent, the receiver measures it. It's a null, what's called a null packet. It contains no data, just the training sequences. The receiver makes some measurements on it and then sends back a measurement to the transmitter of what the characteristic in the other direction was. So now we've got actually a measurement of the characteristics of the channel in both directions. So, excuse me. When you start to look at this in terms of matrix encoding of the MIMO channels, it gets very complicated very quickly. You know, with four transmitters and four receivers, you've got 16 paths. Okay, so each one of these transmitters has got four paths it can serve to four receivers, and you can follow the lines there. I'm not going to go into those. But the point is that the number of matrix, the growth in the number of paths is about the square of the number of transmitters. Okay. So obviously, as an equipment manufacturer, our customers want us to be able to say, okay, if we've got a MIMO signal going on, what kind of response are we getting across the channels? So we make equipment which basically allows customers to look at those sounding packets, look at the frequency response of the channels, and figure out whether there's behavior which is not what they expected. So this is the kind of stuff that we bring to the marketplace. So I talked about one of the things that happens in the AC standard is that we now start to look at 256 QAM instead of 64 QAM. So as soon as you get to this again, as I mentioned before, things like the phase noise of oscillators, the compression of amplifiers, and the linearity of amplifiers becomes more important because, you know, to separate those 256 constellation points in the same spacing, same occupied spacing, gets harder. Okay, so the whole point of doing this is to improve spectral efficiency. It's throughput, but you'll be the same on DOCSIS and all those other channels as well. So one of the things that gets measured is something called EVM, or in the field of wireless LAN manufacturers, they call the same thing relative constellation error. And what that basically is to look at each one of the symbols and look at the vector displacement from the ideal position to where the symbol is actually mapped. And then we give it a number, which we can calculate as a root sum of the squares of all of the displacements. And we then can take a log of that number and multiply by 20. We get something called the RCE. So the spec for these actually had to be slightly relaxed. The spec for 256 QAM is minus 32 dB. On 64 QAM, it's minus 28. So it's actually going to be a more challenging spec to meet. So linearity and phase noise become quite key issues. So, you know, this is the consumer marketplace where you can't put a lot of expense into the product and everyone's competing for getting the best, the cheapest product with the best performance. So these kind of trade-offs are things that people need to be able to evaluate early in the design. And one of the other things that we allow customers to do is to model these behaviors and figure out where the trade-offs are. So this is one of our modeling tools and allows us to simulate an entire transmission receiving chain, put impairments on it, put the channel information on it, simulate the MIMO channel, and then figure out what kind of throughput you're going to get before you've even built anything. Okay? And the whole point of this is that to look at margins to say, okay, what kind of oscillator LO performance do I need to sustain this throughput, and what can I get away with, basically, before I build anything? And it gets expensive. So some of the tools that we supply allow customers to make live measurements on, I don't know if you can see this, but this is a vector signal analysis screenshot of a 256 QAM constellation showing the frequency responses, the EVM on each of the subcarriers, the EVM versus the symbols, and it's a MIMO transmission, so it also shows you the MIMO channel matrix there and the matrix numbers that are involved in that. And again, we can use this kind of tools for looking at things like where the distortions in the signal are coming from in the transmitter and how to rectify them. One of the other things that people want to be able to do with these kind of things is to use lower cost power amplifiers. So the whole concept of pre-distortion, which has been prevalent in the electronics industry now for a few years in transmission systems, becomes very important. So what you basically do is you start off with a lower cost amplifier, which hasn't got very linear performance, and it's got terrible adjacent channel performance. You then pre-distort the signal that you're going to put into it so that after you put the pre-distorted signal through the distorting amplifier, you end up with a performance which was better than you started off with. Now, to do this, you then need to capture third-order and fifth-order components out of the distortion signal to be able to create the correction signal. So that's one of the things that we allow customers to do as well, is to do this interactive characterization to basically get away with cheaper amplifiers. Okay. And there's a number of ways we can generate reference signals. I'm not going to go into detail here. There's just one thing I just want to cover. Things like the spectrum emission masks as well. These are the kind of things that customers need to be able to make sure that when they radiate a signal on the transmitter, it stays within the channel that it's been allocated without spilling too much into the adjacent channel, right? Because people want to reuse those channels at some distance. So this is the maps for the spectrum emission mask for the 40 meg channel, the 80 meg channel. And then when we have the 160 meg channel, you can see we've got another flying saucer there. And then when you have the aggregated, you can have a 80 plus 80 mode, or they can be 80 plus 80 separated. And one of the other things that people need to check here as well is things like spectral flatness. So they need to look at the flatness of the signal across the duration of the signal, or the width of the signal. So those kind of things can be measured fairly automatically as well. And this is just the specifications that people need to meet for the various modulation coding schemes. I'll leave that to you to read. Receiver tests. So the receiver test basically involves injecting signals of a known quality at a known power level into the receiver, sometimes using MIMO transmission to make sure that you can get the actual throughput that you expected, and also the receiver sensitivity. So these graphs here or charts show you the receive sensitivity specifications that are required, again, for the different modulation coding schemes. I'm not going to bore you to death with all of these. So I'll stop at the summary slide here, which basically just talks about what we've just talked about here is what's new in the physical layer. I've not talked about the higher order layers of the 7-layer model, just the physical layer. That's what we've been concerned with here. We talked about the wider channel bandwidths, which are mandated, and also the optional ones. The new higher order modulation scheme, the 256 QAM, the multiple antenna MIMO schemes, and some of the challenges that are involved in testing these things. So I think I'm just about on time. Am I on time?
You're fine. Absolutely fine.
Okay. So I'll stop there. Like I said, there's an awful lot more information about products and where to find more information, et cetera, et cetera. But as I said, I'm I'm not here to bore you to death today, but I'll stop there and I'll just ask if there's any questions.